Ladies and gentlemen, we'll move on to next session. I'm sure you would have seen from the scheduled program, we were now supposed to have a breakout discussion session. I'll very briefly explain it. It is already self-explanatory, it is written there, but I'll just tell you arrangements so that we can break out. So we will be dividing into six groups, each group represented by one of our speak delegates here. I will just tell their names and also corresponding topics.
Okay, we have six themes around which the breakout sessions are distributed. So the idea is that we all of us divide ourselves into six groups, and each group focuses on one theme topic. The theme topics are quality and validation, that would be coordinated by Professor Dr. Baldev Raj. Education coordinated by Professor PVM Rao. Academia to industry by Professor B. Ravi. Supply chain coordinated by Dr. Mukesh Kumar. Manufacturing coordinated by Professor Rajkumar Roy. And design coordinated by me, Amaresh Chakravarti. So the idea is that we will be basically looking at two points only. One is, what are the key lessons, key points that have come out or you want to add to? And second is, what are the actionable items that we want to take forward? For the coordinators of the themes, there is more job to do. We expect that, not immediately, but you know, reasonably soon, that you collate the information and give us a two-page report on your theme. That will go into the overall report. So that's actually quite important. So please take profusely, take notes.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to this summary session. Now, you know, we had breakout sessions, six parallel breakout discussions were there, six groups. Now, I request each group, the leader of the group, he will present for 5 minutes. Now I request Dr. Baldev Raj to give his discussion points. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhujang Rao. It was a pleasure to be with our colleagues. My colleagues in the session on quality and validation were Himadri Ghosh, K.N. Karan, P.K. Sharma, Dr. Banu Prasad and myself. And as you see, we were five Pandavas. And we didn't need sixth one, so it was very good that we could discuss a few things. We realized one difficulty, that quality as perceived or quality as built into many of the products and processes which were talked were not really defined or were not cared. You look at, for example, a comparison with what Dr. Jayadeep presented, some of the products taken from all over the world and including India. They were all to the specifications. They had been packaged very well. There is no pride in showing a rural background as a dirty, unmanaged, that is not rural India. So I think we have to be very clear about the quality, its perceiving and its building and its checking. Having said that, we identified that there are five or six things which we can do. One is the culture of the quality, which comes free, but which is most important part of the quality, that every action you do, it reflects your commitment to a product or a process. This can be done through change leaders, as Himadri Ghosh told us, and these change leaders should work very closely with the people who are doing inclusive manufacturing products and processes, and these change leaders should be very carefully taught as to some things in the quality can be built free of cost, some can be saving cost if you build in quality, and some can be at the cost. So these change agents must know all these things. Second, most of the products which we want to really do the value addition, they can be transformed to the virtual products so that all over the country and all over the world, the people can see that what does this product consist of, right from materials to the tools they use, the tradition of the skill sets, the concepts, and with the advantage of the augmented virtual reality, many things can be brought out. And this can be a portal, in fact, of the all the Indian products which we considered are part of inclusive manufacturing. And this can be even funded through advertisements at some stage, but in the beginning it would have to be done through certain mechanism. Many of us were narrating our experiences, and we were finding that research is done at the high level by the scholars. Diploma holders and technicians do the implementation, and then finally it is most of the people who are not even skilled, so as to say they don't have the formal degree, but they are excellent people, they do it. So we must convert our best practices to do's and don'ts. And we have used this do's and don'ts practice in atomic energy, space and defense, in very high technology, it works. Because finally these are the people, when you see the success of a space shuttle, it is finally sometimes done by a very casual worker who has been brought in to do a part of that job. But they know very well that finally space shuttle would succeed because of this culture can be brought into that. Then we also said that, you see, most of the things are related to cleanliness. To my mind, only country which gives the right recognition to cleanliness is Japan, where at undergraduate level and elective levels, there is a full course on cleanliness. Cleanliness can add a lot of value, can bring the product quality, can cause the pride that this product has been done. Surfaces, which also add to the cleanliness, can add the value. Then quality today has to be through the life cycle. It is absolutely no doubt in anybody's mind. It has to satisfy the requirements of sustainability. It has to satisfy the requirement of reuse and things like that. So can we think of that all these pieces sold in millions and billions sometime, there is a mechanism to reuse so that the minerals are conserved, the costs are brought down, and they are reused. But then if you have to do that, then you have to write a different quality practices for that. What quality products, quality specifications are there with virgin materials, they are not applicable when you reuse them or recycle them. So you have to write a fresh things and all that. But that can be, it's a challenge, but it can be done. So in short, there is a very good material for us as next steps. What we have learned from these presentations, it's all amalgamated into what. Then we are thinking that everywhere if you have to tell a story, people say, give me example. Amul is a great example of inclusive manufacturing. Yesterday, Unilever presented a great example of tea. Diamond cutters in Gujarat are the great example of the quality work at the highest level. Similarly, if you look at Mahabalipuram, where I spent most of my life at Kalpakkam, there are schools which teach the granite sculpturing, and the sculptures they make from tiny size to huge sizes, they are sold all over the world. In fact, they have a booking over years what their sculptures can do, but it is done in a very formal way. Informalization is converted to a formal building up of the things and all that. So we have plenty of things to do, but doable with the kind of competence which we have. And thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Baldevraj. We move on to next speaker, Professor Rai Rajakumar, on manufacturing.
In manufacturing, we had very good debate, I would say, very lively debate. And what we agreed, that there is no dearth of ideas. There are many groups who are developing products, but each one of them probably thinks their product, their ideas are going to solve India's problem. But India's problems are still not getting solved. And I think that's the real issue. Real issue is about all this work is happening, And I have to tell you that this is for the first time in my life I have learned a little bit more about what is actually going on in India. I spent 25 years in India when I didn't know much about India at all. So I had to go out and then come back to learn about India, which is interesting. Few things happening. There are pockets of excellence, both from individual efforts, also corporate efforts, but others don't know it, so there's a lack of sharing of good practice. There's also lack of, I would say, understanding of what rural customer voice actually is. So people in urban areas are actually sitting here or in Delhi or Mumbai or Calcutta defining what they think village wants. And there is a lack of real effort by rural people to consolidate their views, and also people coming from other places go to rural areas and understanding truly what their needs are. So there is a gap there. There is issue about rural productivity, and that drives technology. And one of the things we spent some time on, introduction of technology without consideration of long-term sustainability and how it actually affects the society, not just environmentally. We have to uphold cultural aspects of the society. We have to uphold social fabric of the society. And often that is missed. And maybe the way we were developing technology by ignoring that throughout the world could change. And maybe BRIC countries, maybe India, could lead some of that thought process. So I think there's a real need for thought leadership in defining new order of industrialization. And gentlemen, ladies, let's be very proud to invent that. It's not about poverty. It's a different social mindset, which is thousands of years old. How can you actually improve that society? That should be the goal. We talked about, we really don't know what the problems are. Are we going to plan properly from this IMF to guide some activities which are meaningful, which are impactful, rather than scattergun approach to do small things here and there, and it will be a repeat of what is going on already. And we mentioned that IMF organizers will be thinking very hard, will be working with you, not exactly repeat the same thing, what is already happening, but maybe do a slightly different approach where we need to reflect, we need to prioritize, and then we need to move forward. We talked about the role of materials. We talked about the biggest problem as scale up. How do you scale up some of the relevant ideas, make it available to people? Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Rai Rajkumar. Now on design by Professor Amaresh, please.
Still good morning. This is the team. We started small. I was hoping that just three people can influence the design agenda for the entire IMF for the world, but we were wronged. The others joined immediately after that. So I think our aspiration got slightly curtailed, but I'm very happy. This is a very energetic team that we had, and we deliberated with a lot of passion and points. So let me share some of those points. Before I do that, I just quickly want to also share my life's history of failures. I started at 5 o'clock in the morning thinking that I'll take 1.5 hours. By 6:30, I will summarize the 2 days of deliberations, and then I will come here with Well, I failed miserably. There is such richness that we have created in the last 2 days. It would take weeks to actually assimilate, if not longer. So these are the key points. We first felt that the fact that design is essential for inclusive manufacturing is something that we need to communicate. So communication is actually a very important part of it. We tried to emphasize that earlier, that as you go earlier in the development phase, the importance of your decision making becomes far more, you know, far greater, while you don't spend so much resources to take those decisions. And that is what empowers design as a key entity in this whole game. And we need to communicate that. Now, the questions that came is what to communicate, how to communicate, and who to communicate. For example, you know, MSME would certainly be a very important stakeholder to which we would like to communicate that. Daniel Steenstra very emphatically, and that's why I'm quoting it, said that there is actually no difference between a car designer and a doctor, and he happens to be both, by the way. What he meant was that there is an underlying philosophy and a methodology that cuts across disciplines, and we must make people aware of that and probably sensitize and possibly even teach. You know, so we all go through identifying problems, developing ideas, working these out, trying it out, modifying, and so on. And that would make it scalable. You know, we can move it scalability at a training level. The role of the designer for inclusive manufacturing, what are the key traits? So we have been listing some there. You know, immersion came out as a very important one, and we need to be sensitive to the aspirations. And this has been already mentioned, that it is not about solving poverty. It's far greater than that. It is really, you know, figuring out what people want and catering to that. So aspiration plays a critical role there. And second element was tools and techniques. What kind of tools and techniques we can empower our designing with? So we need to synthesize elements to deal with complexity. That's what designers do. There are many tools that are available, but how do we adapt them for the purposes of inclusive manufacturing? That's, I think, a key questions. Not only how do you adapt, but make them available and mentor in order to carry that out. And the importance of free and open source is stressed as probably a major game changer in carrying these out. The other key points is, of course, design process for the informal sector. You know, how do we integrate sustainability into the design process? This is not part of a norm or curriculum in the courses right now, and I think that will play an important role. The thinking of the whole life cycle, and how do we catch the unarticulated needs? You know, many of the things that people say are not necessarily the ones that they want. And then many of the things that they want are something that they are not explicitly aware of. So how do we catch them? Of course, we need to interact with and consult multiple stakeholders. We need to also design not just the product or the process, but the business model, because it has to be sustainable. And that will require the stakeholders to be interested in actually carrying this out. Now, what should we do differently for the informal sector? And many points came, I just noted it down. We need to speak in a language of the stakeholder. You know, maybe there are different media, different communication that we should look at. Puppetry was mentioned earlier in one of the presentations. Are there, you know, puppet shows that we should be using in interacting with the user? You know, how do we adopt tools and techniques? How do we incentivize the stakeholders? And can designing be transferred next time so that those for whom we are developing the solutions don't have to come back to us for next time for developing solutions? They can be from solution receivers to solution getters. So just slides on actionable items. You know, can we create networks? These are some of the points that came from our earlier discussions. From Raj, for example, how do we build on existing achievements, influence government initiatives? These are some of the points that we already had before we started the discussion. We started with these ones. You know, we need to transfer not only the solution, but also how to solve. Education came out as a very strong theme. You know, how do we educate people to design? You know, both awareness and education. Children, grassroots innovators, and very interestingly, engineers as well. You know, because they don't have design as an ingrained element of education at the moment. Hands-on experience should play a very important role. And somebody suggested that, can we make it compulsory that every parent should design a toy for their children or along with their children. How to use design thinking to design inclusive manufacturing program and policy, communicate the importance, co-design, and how to involve the user in the design phase. Need to have a vision for the society as well as designing society. That is what we are trying to do in some sense. We're trying to change the society. So we collectively need to have a vision for what is the kind of society that we would like to have for which we are designing. And probably the last point that I want to emphasize is that, you know, these are some of the elements that how do you design with local resources? You know, normally we just open this big materials chart and say, what is the best material to choose? But if you are designing for a community, we should say, right, how do you close the cycle? And therefore, what are the materials that are available? What are the people that are available? How do we design for them, with them, by them eventually? So that's the main points that came out. Is there anything I have missed? Please join, but otherwise, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Amaresh. Now I request Professor Ravi on academic industry interaction.
So we had a bigger group, 17 people whose names you can see. I'm immensely thankful to all of them for joining us and very passionately talking, so much that we never realized when the time for tea was up. And but many of the themes are reflecting from Amaresh and Professor Baldev. Also, I am sure it will reflect in Professor PVM Rao's thing also. Education, for example, was a recurring theme. So what we did was to divide into six groups of points, and all of them are kind of actionable points. So in each of these, we have some insights and some actionable points. So those six are basically redefining the goals. Attitudes was a major thing. Education, which is across all of them, came up, and I'll show you some points in that. And enablers, scaling up as well as enablers. So the first one, goals, we kind of redefined that whatever we do, we cannot lose sight of the overall goal, which is essentially that inclusive manufacturing, the way, whatever we define. I know Amaresh has been trying to define, but I think it is such a complex thing that just to put it in the right perspective will take us a few days. Some of the brackets which you see are the points which came up from yesterday, picked and chose, other points which came up in the discussions in today's breakout session. So one of the main thing was that we need, academics do not have any mechanism or incentive or expectation of working with industry. They expect to teach, at the most do research. But how do you incentivize them? How do you get them to do that? A few passionate people can make a difference, but you're losing out on 90% of faculty or scientists who can make a difference. So we need mechanisms to do that. And to do that, we need to have various things, which is essentially bring academia industry together, and we'll see in some other slides also. Like, for example, networks and communication. And we need some champions who know the two sides, and they are the ones who trigger. They become catalysts for bringing it together. This was a huge thing. In fact, we spent, I think, almost 30% time on that. Attitude, if we can, in fact, perhaps this is the cornerstone of the whole thing. If we can change attitude, I think a lot of things will already automatically fall into place. So, for example, our notion, like yesterday they said, throwing money like water is no longer true. Water is actually more expensive than perhaps money, okay? And not only minimizing waste in manufacturing, but whatever waste is produced, to reuse that to create, you know, products and wealth and things like that. Two points which came yesterday, which also was appreciated, that scientists should appreciate the value being added by industry and also by people who have made it big in industry but do not necessarily have a so-called formal education. So that appreciation is one first step. So scientists have to lower their egos and appreciate other people. One other point was that, like, doctors are supposed to, are asked to work in field. Can we ask engineers to work in field? Because I'm aware that many education institutes, including IITs, have stopped works visits because of the sheer numbers involved. But maybe it's a time to bring it back and give the exposure to students to with industry. And in industry here, I'm using a loose way. Industry means anything which is real life. And one other point which came is that most academics who teach manufacturing haven't manufactured anything in their life. So how can you expect them to teach? So how do we have mechanisms by which, and some mechanisms were there in USA, and then they are there in Germany. And those who don't know manufacturing can't teach manufacturing. But we need to bring in some kind of a policies to make sure that only those who know manufacturing can teach manufacturing. Otherwise, imagine a heart surgeon teaching heart surgery without having done ever a surgery, right? I mean, we are supposed to be professional education. The CSR point came up, it was discussed in various dimensions. On one hand, the CSR is about industry looking only at visibility, But also if you sensitize them properly, then CSR can be leveraged very beautifully to get them into inclusive manufacturing and so on. And perception needs to change. The rural and urban academics and industry, they are not from Mars and Venus kind of a thing. I need a better word for this. But we need to change the perception that we need to understand each other. So attitude was a huge thing that was discussed. Now some mechanisms for engagement were discussed. For example, both approaches, forward approach and reverse approaches, were discussed. Forward is where academics build some technology and then give it to industry. And the reverse one, where you look at application first and then do research necessary for that. But by and large, the consensus is that the second approach is the right approach. You must engage with the end users, if not in the first step, at least second step, and then do research. Okay, so that is perhaps better. And academics have to engage in multiple ways. We're talking about involve various stakeholders, learn from them. Academics have to stay in the rural areas and so on, or with the people to learn from them, appreciate them. That mentioned to you, internships, bring it back. So I'm actually eating into a lot of education related things which people have present, but this was one of the very passionate discussions about how do you bring the interests of students and academia into. But we'd also appreciate academics, that's not the job. Our job is to teach. But I'm questioning that what we're teaching is irrelevant. So that also has to be. And we should not also demonize industry all the time. I mean, industry is doing a job. Their job is to make profit. So this was my understanding of this session is that these questions are quite complex. And we cannot just do a half an hour brainstorming and say we have some panacea or solutions for that. We have to mull over it. There are many, many facets of that. But it's a starting point to keep the engagement up. Three more slides. One was scaling up was the important point. But one theme was, unless we say that scaling up is not necessarily always good, especially when it's leading to unsustainable mechanisms. Very clearly that government projects can be used to do an initial experiment, but not continue to fund it forever. So you need to build in mechanisms for sustainability. This is a point which is well known. But what people lose sight is that when you do a pilot project, we are doing only a pilot project. We are not thinking all the way about how it is going to scale up. So that thought process has to be incorporated as you start a government project. That was one point. And need for systematic approaches and mechanisms was very important. Now last two, one is technology enablers. They are kind of known devils. So judicious automation. And when you do automation, we cannot stop automation from taking, it's like a demon. It's like letting a demon out of the bag. So it will take its own shape. You cannot stop people being displaced. So plan for automation displacing people and training them and reorienting them has to be planned as you think about that. And the usual suspects in technology, you can see that, including village manufacturing centers, micro factories, and not only leverage technology, but also best practices from great places like ISRO and nuclear, which have done very well, and integrated platforms. But one point, and which I think was reflecting an ambitious thing, enhance the design and technology development capability of the end users. We can't ask them to be dependent on us all the time. Enable them to create their own technology, their own processes, products, and so on. I think that was very valuable last point. Last slide is about other enablers, and there's a big basket list of various things. So training, educating rural people about how to do business. Some practices are very valuable. Enabling them and also making them appreciate the value of patenting, which came from Premnath yesterday and also today justified more. And other things like certification. Because Vishwanathan's thing about how do you ensure the trustability of the ingredients in food chain could be applied to any other chains. Okay, and also technology foresighting. I think we are not very, very good at, we do have technology documents coming up once in a while. But I think still maybe it has to be better in terms of the impact of technology on the sustainability and social aspects has not perhaps been that well thought about, and that has to be one point which has to come up and look 30 years later and so on. And Professor Karunakaran mentioned that, for example, IITs have a very nice system of only teaching 8 months in a year. So 4 months students are actually free in which we can engage them in internship, and they do internships. But many other engineering colleges, and that's 99-95% of engineering colleges, they are engaged in courses almost the whole year, and plus exams. So I think freeing them up as per IIT model, at least that's one good thing among many things in IIT model, it can be mapped into that. So these are some of the points. We tried to prioritize, but we ran out of time. So perhaps we will still continue on the email and try to look at some priority items, which are also somewhat novel. What will Modi ji look, you know, as an interesting idea, things like that. So we will continue on the deliberations. But thank you for to my team, and thank you to all for listening.
Thank you, Professor Ravi. Now I'll request Professor PVM Rao on education.
Okay, good afternoon. We just crossed the noon. Okay. So unlike five Pandavas, we were seven. I forgot to capture, so I can call as Satya Pe Sata. So I think there are some of the common observations which came during last 2 days were captured. So I thought first I'll put some observations and then action items. So one of the observations which came is that there's not enough knowledge creation activities or courses which probably give opportunity for students to engage in knowledge creation and subjects like inclusive manufacturing in our institutes and universities. So that's a need which need to be filled. And also there are a lot of examples of good prototypes which are coming out. In some cases it have reached like one user or two users. But I think the moment you try to take them to, let's say, 10,000 or 500,000, you need to completely have a completely a different design and manufacturing philosophy for that, which is actually not happening. In other words, instead of one person, if I want to take it to, let's say, 500,000, how do I take care of maintenance, warranty? You don't bother about those aspects, kind of a thing. Other thing which was also there is that why many of the innovations are actually not going ahead beyond, let's say, a very limited prototyping experience is also that we are not addressing all the life cycle issues, which, as I mentioned. And this is another one where we looked at many of the SMEs and startups and nonprofits do not have a seamless entry into educational institutes. Still, there is a lot of gap. Most of them, they mentioned the kind of problems they face in interacting with educational institutes. It's at all levels, physical resources like equipment, machines, human resources like student, and intellectual resources like faculty and others. And it's also seen that there is a large part of inclusive manufacturing happens in unorganized sector, and there is a clear gap between how to engage with, let's say, people in informal sector with educational institutes. I think we haven't still found a good model for that. That's something which is a gap. And a couple of other observations is there are very limited opportunities for people of informal sector to be benefited by what happens in educational institutes, which is there. And also, it was also pointed out by some of our members that our education system is more of which actually looks at, follows most of the Western model rather than looking at more futuristic, future requirements of the country. These were some of the clear observations which came up. And the action items were very crisp. First thing which was there is it possible to have a one credit course on social immersion for all students very early in the programs? Whether it's engineering or social sciences, design or management, this could be something which is a first introduction for people to understand how the world works. Because a lot of technology teaches how the things work, but I think it's extremely important to know how the world works. And second aspect is either mandatory or elective, where we did not have a consensus, is to have a course on inclusive innovation or inclusive manufacturing, which is basically a team-based and goal-oriented in our courses as a part of the programs. Is it possible to create? This should be one of the recommendations. Depending on the institutes, it can be mandatory or elective. How it happens could be one of them. When we say goal-oriented, again, it could be you probably end up with just a solution. In some case, look-alike, work-alike prototypes. In some cases, it could be functional prototypes. So that is also left little loose, how people would like to plan. And then some people said ki there should be backup courses to take these things ahead, kind of a thing. It should be a multi-semester courses and kind of thing. The third is, in case if you run a course on, let's say, inclusive manufacturing or inclusive innovation, and let's say if there are 20 teams which are working, and let's say there are 5 bright ideas which have potential to reach market, society, or industry, how do you provide, how do you keep these projects alive? By providing a small seed funding to faculty student team to take it ahead. How do we create such opportunities within educational institutes was discussed. And also, this is very important. The moment we say an inclusive manufacturing, the connection with the outside world is an extremely important. Presently, in our educational systems, we don't have a good frameworks to interact with outside world. Even like there are cases, like in one of the cases, it was mentioned that teacher wanted to take a group of students to, let's say, an immersion to a rural area, and principal told ki there are no such budget for such things. There are no, there's no provision in our budget for such activities. So the kind of frameworks which you need to create, I think it's a bi-directional. How do you bring the people who are in inclusive innovation on the field into the campus? And second thing is, how do you take students to immerse in the real world to actually identify the need and solutions and co-create is an extremely important, and we need to find more such mechanisms to do that. Similarly, it was felt that there are a lot of engineering colleges and other colleges do wonderful projects, which are probably few hundred thousand projects or few hundreds of thousands of projects which comes. Is it possible to identify a few potential of them and give them an additional year of fellowship to pursue those ideas, to basically see that there is a very high possibility that the benefits actually reach either market, industry, or society? Can we create such fellowships was one. And having very successful, I think one of the good thing which happened in last 2 days is that we have seen a lot of good case studies. Is it possible to prepare a good case studies and use them as a curricula if you are offering such courses was another idea which came. And a lot of inclusive manufacturing which happens in institutes, particularly students, require a lot of mentorship, which institute themselves cannot provide. So is it possible to have a mentor-mentee cloud network where if I have a problem, when I don't have answers coming from, let's say, within my institute, can I just flag it off because I have a mentor network which is available, was one of the models suggested. And this was a more of them. If some institutes would like to have a major program, let's say a master's program in inclusive manufacturing or this thing, then there should be a provision. Well, that's a welcome idea. But any such program should not be basically put as a part of one entity, because it requires a multiple inputs of social sciences, engineering, management, arts and design, etc. So it has to be truly a multidisciplinary program, if at all such a program is planned by some of the institutes, universities. The last page is that, is it possible to create inclusive manufacturing internships and externships? Internship for students and externship for faculty. I think UK model is a very good of having externship for faculty to spend outside at least 2 weeks, which we heard earlier was one of the good ideas. And how do we put like guest and adjunct faculty position to successful innovators from various parts to come to the campus was another idea. Then this was another very interesting suggestion which came is ki in DST we have a lot of funding schemes. So is it possible to create another vertical which can be under inclusive innovation or manufacturing at 3 different stages, idea to POC, early transition, and pilot. And they require different type of work and different type of teams and different type of funding levels. So this is another action item which was suggested. One of the strong suggestion was that after this particular thing, do we have a portal on inclusive manufacturing where people can contribute as well as access to this. And also mention was made of special incubator in inclusive manufacturing. Like we have a special incubators in healthcare. We have like 16 of those now in the country. So is there anything like in inclusive manufacturing which is happening? And this was very important that the faculty who engage in such activities generally do not get, I think these do not feature in the metrics of evaluation. For example, we have good metrics for knowledge creation in terms of research, publications, citations, impact factors, etc. We also kind of struggle to have evaluation metrics for teaching, which is not easy. But is it possible to have evaluation metrics for innovation and knowledge application activities was another one. And this was, I think here it was only a suggestion, there was no crisp as to what should be the initiative for skill building and vocational training for non-formal sectors and what is the role of educational institutes in this was also discussed. And last slide is, since we also have an international community, it was thought key what could be possible collaboration models. So I think there are possible where students, faculty and industry on either side, and we can have multiple models, student-student, student-faculty, student-SME, SME-SME. I don't know what is the shape it can take, but these are all possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Rao. Now I request Dr. Mukesh Kumar on supply chain.
Yeah, I was there. It's on supply chain. We were quite minority group. Only myself and Professor Viswanathan were there. But I think Professor Viswanathan enough or quite extensive experience really, really added value to this. So I really, generally I don't follow rules, but my wife trained me how to follow rules these days. And so what I did is actually I follow religiously what you asked, two questions to follow and find an answer. But before going to two questions, we had an agreement or kind of observation that we both thought it's quite good, is what is inclusive manufacturing and what we learn in, I think I was not there on the first day, but what we have learned from various presentations. So as per our understanding, we thought it's about creating product services for rural and urban population, those who can't afford it. And the product characteristic that people were talking during this our presentation is affordable, sustainable, value to customer, and also accessible. And what kind of products that we should be looking at, and various products that we actually looked at is quite, it's actually making human lives better. It's the basic needs of the human, roti, kapda or makan, even going to healthcare and Dubai kind of area. And all this perspective of inclusive manufacturing, what we have thought is, there are two perspectives basically emerge, a societal perspective which incorporates customer and product point of view. There's another perspective which not discussed that much in length, but I think Professor Baldev Raj has mentioned about Amul. So it's about employment generation as well to some extent. And the labor conditions, smart village and town, and kind of areas that we were looking at. So I'll go back to the question that I was asked. What are the learnings from the past for the role of supply chain in inclusive manufacturing? As we know, inherently, supply chain is quite complex system. It has, at the heart of supply chain, there are factories, and there are factories and factories of the suppliers and distribution centers. So what we have learned till now in last 2 years, 2 days presentation is supply chain for inclusive manufacturing is quite disintegrated. The actors are not talking to each other. And this integration is across the value chain. When we are also talking about the design elements, whether the product is designed for the customers. These supply chains are also long and geographically dispersed. And that leads to the problem of poor quality and inefficiency and higher cost. Last mile is one of the biggest challenge that we have observed in the presentations that we have looked at. That leads to also labor, and another challenge is of labor productivity, new technology adoption. Big gap between demand and supply. I think previous work group also talked about whether are we making these products for the people that they need. So this is the product which people really need in the rural area. or it's just the product that we are making for the sake of making it. Supply chain scale-up is another point that is actually coming up. So lots of solutions we have heard from product perspective, lots of design and interesting products are being designed. But why it's not been scale-up to other parts of India? And not just India, why not beyond India? So what are the challenges, why not supply chain, what are the challenges that supply chain can solve in this area? So these are the learning from the past that we think about role of supply chain, that supply chain can play an important role in solving these problems. Now, coming back to the what are the issues and challenges should be tackled within short term and medium term? That's the second question we ask. And one of the things that again is quite echoed in other talks as well, other groups' view, is can we do landscape studies for inclusive manufacturing, linking technology, product, demand, supply? It's almost like, as in UK, we have manufacturing landscape studies. Can we do it for rural area? Keeping in mind that India is quite diversified. It's not a kind of country which like looks unified. So northern side of India, eastern side of India, western side of India, southern side of India, everywhere there are different requirements, different competences. Keeping in those things in mind, can we actually do 1 or 2 years or 6 or 7 month studies in this area in order to inform or better inform future innovation for inclusive manufacturing? Another topics that we thought that we should be dealing in medium term, looking at supply chain scale up, how one innovator or startup has started making a product with limited means of distribution, how they can go across pan-India market. And all these things is also linked to digital supply chain, which we think that will make the difference. So how we can design digital supply chain, what kind of infrastructure it requires and how it can be developed. Developing small scale industries, and it's more near to the production. So we are talking about where the population, where the consumption is, can we actually create production there as well? And in all these things, what is more important that we need to be careful if we don't do it correctly is value distribution. And I think I should say value redistribution, because it has to be supported with viable economic means. Current value distribution system, somebody makes huge amount of money, others can't make another money. So we need to think about how the value in inclusive manufacturing can be distributed fairly across the supply chain and value chain. That's the conclusion that we had. If anything I've missed, Professor Vidwanathan?
You did an excellent job.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mukesh. In fact, this session we have come to end, but there is a request from Professor Satish Vasu Kailas. He would like to say some new points for us today.
Okay. I thank Dr. Baldev Raj. I just requested him 5 minutes to 7 minutes to make this presentation. So I just prepared this in between. I gave the title, Technology Care is Required. What I spoke previously was about science without sustainability and sustainability without science are both meaningless. You need to close the cycle, and these should be the cornerstones of development. Efficiency, power are secondary. And sustainability is binary, either sustainable or unsustainable. Now, what I would like to say is give one example of how technology intervened in the villages and has created a huge problem. So the example is how a closed loop that was there for centuries opened up. This is a water usage cycle in agriculture. The old water cycle, a part of yearly water cycle for greater than 5,000 years, was you had clouds, you had rains, you had water collecting in ponds and wells, and these were used for farming. And the output from the farm was used for, apart from food, for humans, for cattle, and the feed out of the the output from the cattle, or what one can call bullshit, was used as fertilizer. And the important thing was every summer the lakes used to be desilted, and this silt was mixed with the cow dung and put back as fertilizer. And of course the hydrological cycle is closed. Now what happened was what this existed was a closed loop. It's completely closed, zero dependence on outside world for the farmer to survive. It became an open loop when chemical fertilizers were introduced into this thing. Because chemical fertilizers, the two things are mining of phosphates and hydrocarbons. I'm sorry, this formatting changed when I cut and paste. And when these chemical fertilizers started to be used, the biofertilizer usage reduced. And the important thing was this desilting of the lakes stopped. Net result was the lakes and ponds completely silted up, and the water levels, which were something like 3 to 10 meters when I was young, I learned swimming in a huge well, 40 feet in diameter, and you are pushed into the well if you would refuse to jump. Of course, none of us died. I'm sure if my parents knew it even today, they would be worried what this guy has done when he was young. And of course, we had company of snakes and other things in the well also. So that time the water was at 3 meters to 10 meters, not more than that. Today, because of this complete desilting of silting of lakes, you can see the water levels have dropped to 100 to 500 meters. If you are lucky, you will get water. In most places around Bangalore, even places where these open wells are, they are completely gone. And basically what I argue here is that, of course, the subsidies also are killing. The unsustainable cycle, the cycle has been opened, the lakes are not desilted, the yearly groundwater recharge reduced and stopped, the wells have become deeper, very deep, the cycle has become power intensive from 1 kilowatt to 15 kilowatt pumps, if you can pump. The power has become fossil fuel intensive, and only the rich farmer can survive. And more importantly, there are more dissolved salts in the water, and that you need to purify. In fact, this is where we started. The arrow is again because of the formatting problem. When I cut and paste, this is where we started, actually. When some of my students took up a project on water purification, we went around trying to collect collected water samples and found out the fluoride content in that. And we found that this problem did not exist 30 years back. And why did it exist? When we started building up the cycle, that's how I got interested in sustainability and closing the loop. So it was because of a project that I worked with Professor Pradeep in IIT Madras to design for packaging. So basically, this cycle that where you have more dissolved salts in water, still more power to purify, and it becomes more unsustainable. So what has happened is a good closed loop, because of technology, has been opened up and created a problem. But then people would ask this question, and have asked this question about, what about feeding the population? Because you can say you ban chemical fertilizers, but what about feeding the population? This is where I collect the data from the Reserve Bank of India's website. What I plotted is from 1956 to 2013 data. I have data more, I have not changed the graph, but it doesn't change the nature of the graph in any case. You see the fertilizer used in lakh tons, and the blue line is actually the, I'm sorry again for cut and paste created problems. The green line is the food production output, and the blue line is the amount of irrigated land. So when you plot a graph, you need to see what are the things that go into the fertilizer, into the production of food. And when you see these two things, you see that both of them are linked to it. But if you look at the initial growth phase from 1950, you see that the irrigation is what is more closely linked to the output in terms of food production and not the fertilizer usage. The fertilizer usage picked up much later, but the food production is directly linked to the irrigation. And you must realize one thing, when the biofertilizer usage reduced as we increase the amount of chemical fertilizer usage. But if I can plot the later data and throw off one of these curves and say that fertilizer usage is what led to this thing, but the early data clearly shows that it is not fertilizer usage, chemical fertilizer usage, that led to the growth in things. And further data here, area under cultivation and irrigated area, you can see that the area under cultivation in India has kept 1980s, it peaked out and then actually fell down, whereas the irrigated area is keeping on increasing. And this, again, can be plotted to the yield per hectare. Even the yield per hectare is linked to the irrigated area, but you can also plot it as a function of the fertilizer usage and show that it is fertilizer which led to higher yield. But truth is, this is what it is. And why I say this is the truth, taking the early data, fertilizer thing. And the second example I would take is efficiency product to a higher efficiency, where you have these kind of light sources, right from oil lamps now to the high efficiency LEDs. The efficiency, energy to light overall luminous efficacy is oil lamp is 0.3 lumen per watt, and you can see that when you come to LED it is 60 to 200 lumen per watt, obviously very, very, very efficient. But you look at the materials in light sources, oil lamps are vegetable, mineral oils, cotton, glass or earthen pot can be made using complete manual labor. Incandescent bulb lamps, you had tungsten, glass, copper, iron and some rare earths for special applications. CFLs, you have mercury, also a big contribution there. Again, there is a small formatting problem here, in down was the LED where you have even gallium in that. Now, these have created an enormous amount of pollution in the villages, especially the use of CFLs. The level of pollution that is there, there's much of the water now is contaminated there. Have you ever thought what happens to your tube light or your CFL that's all hanging here after its use? What it goes is goes into the landfill, breaks there, mercury leaches out, comes into the water system, you use it, your people use it for agriculture and it comes back to you. 60% of Bangalore's vegetables are contaminated with more than unacceptable limits of mercury, lead and other things. So if you look at normalized resource depletion, if incandescent bulb is put as 1, CFL is 3 to 26 times the thing. This includes the energy used for running it. And LED is 2 to 3 times, CFL and LED flunk hazardous waste test. Good old oil lamp, it should be negative, and this is from American Chemical Society publication data. Now, of course, they didn't put the oil part of it, oil lamp part of it. So you must see that even by moving into a product that is more efficient, you're actually creating a bigger problem. So can this be made sustainable? You can recycle all the material in a CFL, capture all the mercury, capture all the tungsten, capture all the glass, capture all other materials, make a device that does that. And this device should not use energy from fossil fuels. I don't know if other energies are sustainable. I have my own doubts on that. So thank you for giving me this time.
Thank you, Professor Satish.